Good afternoon. My name is Damien Corabeuf. I'm working for Clear2Pay, a payment company based in Belgium. Before I start, I would like to know a bit better your Jenkins installation. For example, how many of you have more than 10 jobs in their Jenkins installation? Yeah, I was expecting something like that. More than 100 jobs. More than 1,000 jobs. It's already a bit less. In my company, last time I counted, we had more than 1,100 jobs, and this number keeps increasing while I'm talking. And my talk will be about how to avoid to create a jungle of jobs when you deal with such an amount. So how did we get to such a situation first? It's mostly because we are developing one framework in Clear2Pay, and on top of this framework, we develop products. And on top of those products, we develop projects that we finally release to customers. It creates, of course, dozens and dozens of combinations. And for each of those projects, we have several versions to maintain. So it creates additional combinations. And for each of those versions, we have also a pipeline. And we compile, we package, we publish, we deploy on different platforms, we run acceptance testing. And in the end, we consolidate everything in order to go further to our testing team and to the customer. So that's why we have such an amount of jobs. The problem is that we have a lot of jobs, but we are very few in our team. And it was, of course, out of question to administrate jobs manually. So we had to find a solution. We wanted a solution where actually project could have a self-service from Jenkins, so they could define on their own without any intervention. We wanted also a secure solution because those projects, they are critical for the customer, and we did not want the project team to mess the pipeline and suddenly we couldn't release any longer. We wanted this solution to be simple because it's not the case in this room, of course, but most of the developers I deal with, they don't know Jenkins that well, and even less, they don't know how to administrate them. And we wanted this solution, on top of that, to be flexible enough in order to allow for extensions. So we started to have a solution with a job DSL plugin. But this solution, as such, was not completely satisfactory for us because from a self-service and extensibility point of view, of course, it was OK. But it was not secure enough and definitely not simple enough because, I mean, if you know Jenkins, if you know how to configure job, you know how to code the DSL. But for a developer lambda, it's not that easy. So we still use a job DSL plugin, but we embed it in pipeline DSL libraries. And that's our responsibility, the Jenkins team in Clear2Pay, to manage and version those pipeline DSL libraries. And in order to use them, the development teams will just define what we call a shopping list, and that defines which pipeline libraries they want to use and what parameters they want to give to this pipeline library. I will go into more details, of course. So a pipeline DSL library is just a jar with a standard structure where we have a Groovy file in there which defines the kind of pipeline that the DSL should define for this type of pipeline, of course. And we have several pipeline libraries for different types of projects. We have supporting classes for this DSL script. And of course, we can have dependencies like third-party libraries, but also other pipeline DSL libraries. The shopping list on the other end of the spectrum, we didn't want it to be code-based because, as I said, we didn't want to take any risk. Yeah, we are dealing with critical projects. So we just show the property file. I mean, everybody knows how a property file is designed. And in this file, we have a standard property where we define actually the pipeline and the version we want to use for your project. And the rest of the pipeline is specific to the rest of the shopping list, sorry, is specific to your pipeline, and you configure what kind of option you want to have in your pipeline. For example, here I say I want to support two different versions of a WebSphere process server. And you could also define extension and configure them here. So you have a very structured way to define what you want to have in your pipeline. It was possible in our case because most of our pipelines are very similar to each other. They have differences, they support different platforms, but there was a high level of reuse. A big advantage of having this kind of solution is that your shopping list, which defines your pipeline, lives together with your branch, your version in this case. It allows you a high level of traceability, and it allows you at any time in history to come back to a version which was shipped to the customer, and you know which pipeline exactly has been used to deliver this version, and you can just recreate the complete pipeline from scratch. So how does it look like? We have basically, we have a seed job that we use to initiate the process, that sample tools we have in Clear2Pay here. And from the seed job, we generate a project folder, and everything in this folder will deal with the project only, and we deal with authorization. That's only the project member can see what's inside. Inside the project, we'll have a seed as well, which will be used to generate a branch pipeline, and we have all the branch information into a folder. And so on, in the branch folder, we have a seed which allows to generate the complete pipeline. So how does it work? We have a seed plugin, which is available on GitHub, by the way, and it generates a project seed, which generates a branch seed. This branch seed will actually read information from the branch itself. We support Subversion and Git. And according to the shopping list, we'll select the correct pipeline DSL, run it in order to generate a branch pipeline. If we plug on top of it some triggers, we can completely run into autopilot mode, because then as a developer, I can just trigger my branch seed. I have a new branch pipeline completely from scratch, but I can also just edit my shopping list, and on push, automatically my pipeline will be regenerated. So there is no intervention any longer from the Jenkins team. So we have a strict separation of concern here. We define the pipeline because we know Jenkins very well and we know how to manage that. And on the other side, the development teams, they just do their shopping and take boxes and that's it. They don't pay yet, but okay. So now, I think we just avoided the Jenkins altogether and we can really relax and focus on more interesting things like scaling of the infrastructure and so on. But from a pure pipeline administration point of view, we don't manage any longer any Jenkins job using the graphical interface. And projects, actually, they don't know Jenkins at all, but it's okay because they just do their shopping, and that's it. So I think that's it for my talk. If you have any question, I don't know how much time is left, but I'm available still after the conference, and there is my Twitter account here, and the address of the seed plugin in Jenkins itself. Thank you very much for your attention.